Έντιμε, κύριε πρώην Υπουργέ Υγείας, κύριε Πρίτανη, ακαδημαϊκά μέλη της πανεπιστημιακής μας κοινότητας, κυρία Χατσόπουλος, καλώς ορίσατε, κυρίες και κύριοι αγαπητές φοιτήτριες, αγαπητοί φοιτητές, καλησπέρα σας. Σήμερα έχουμε την τιμή και τη χαρά να φιλοξενούμε εδώ, στο Πανεπιστήμιο Κύπρου, την Ελληνοαμερικανίδα επιχειρηματία και επενδυτικό άγγελο, κυρία Μαρίνα Χατσόπουλος. Μια πολύ ισχυρής προσωπικότητα και εξαίρετη μέντορας, οι αρετές της οποίας εκφράζουν το περιεχόμενο, την ουσία και την φιλοσοφία της επιτυχημένης επιχειρηματικότητας και των δυναμικών επενδύσεων. Η συζήτηση που θα ακολουθήσει μετά τη διάλειξή της, με τίτλο «Τα βασικά στοιχεία για μια επιτυχημένη επιχείρηση», θα εστιάσει στην κατανόηση των πιο σημαντικών στρατηγικών ζητημάτων που αντιμετωπίζει μια επιχείρηση στα αρχικά της στάδια και στο πώς μπορούν οι επιχειρηματίες να επικεντρώσουν την προσοχή τους στις πιο κρίσιμες αποφάσεις για την επιτυχία τους. Καλώ ευθύς αμέσως στο βήμα τον Πρίτανη του Πανεπιστημίου Κύπρου, καθηγητή Κωνσταντίνο Χριστοφίδη, για να χαιρετήσει το σημερινό γεγονός. Κύριε Πρίτανη.
Καλησπέρα σας. Κύριε Πρόεδρε του Συμβουλίου, αγαπητές και αγαπητοί συνάδελφοι, αγαπητές φοιτήτρες, αγαπητοί φοιτητές, αγαπητή Μαρίνα, κυρίες και κύριοι. Πριν από ένα μήνα περίπου, σε ένα dinner στην Βοστόνη, είχα την ευκαιρία να βρεθώ και να συζητήσω με πάρα πολλούς Κύπριους και Ελλαδίτες της Διασποράς και ακριβώς να δούμε πώς μπορούμε μαζί να σπρώξουμε την επιχειρηματικότητα υψηλής τεχνολογίας, κυρίως στην πατρίδα μας. Εκείνη τη συνάντηση για μένα ήταν πάρα πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα. Ανταλλάξαμε πάρα πολλές ιδέες και φάνηκε πραγματικά ότι στη Διασπορά έχουμε ένα ολόκληρο κόσμο ο οποίος μπορεί μαζί μας να δημιουργήσει το καινούριο. Όταν πριν από τη συνάντηση αυτή ήμουνα στον Berkeley και είναι χώροι που στον αέρα αντιλαμβάνεται κανείς το άρωμα, αν θέλετε, αυτό που λέμε καινοτομία, επιχειρηματικότητα. Αντιλαμβάνεται κανείς την θέληση, ειδικά των νέων ανθρώπων, να δημιουργήσουν και να φτιάξουν το καινούριο. Και ακριβώς η σημερινή συνάντηση είναι μια πρώτη συνάντηση, γιατί θα ακολουθήσουν πολλές άλλες γύρω από τη δυνατότητα να φτιάξουμε στο Πανεπιστήμιο Κύπρου ένα ειδικό φαντ, μαζί με άλλους φυσικά, έτσι ώστε να μπορέσουμε να χρηματοδοτήσουμε καινοτομίες που θα παράγονται κυρίως και από τους δικούς μας ανθρώπους εδώ στο Πανεπιστήμιο Κύπρου. Με λίγα λόγια, θέλουμε οι απόφοιτοί μας, οι φοιτητές μας, να προσπαθούν να δημιουργούν το καινούριο και αυτοί με τη σειρά τους αργότερα να εργοδοτούν, αν θέλετε, νέους απόφοιτους. Δηλαδή, προτείνουμε στην κοινωνία και κατ' επέκταση στην πολιτεία ένα καινούριο ενάρετο κύκλο ανάπτυξης. Αυτό προσπαθούμε να κάνουμε και αυτό προσπαθούμε να χτίσουμε. Και νομίζω η Μαρίνα είναι ο καλύτερος πρέσβης για αυτών των ιδεών. Και είμαι σίγουρος ότι σε λίγο θα δούμε πάρα πολλά πράγματα γύρω από αυτό το θέμα. Να πω ένα μεγάλο ευχαριστώ επίσης στον συνάδελφο τον Μάριο Δικιάκο, γιατί τρέχει αυτή την προσπάθεια μαζί με τον κύριο Κασίνη. Στην Βοστόνη, ένας πολύ καλός φίλος επίσης, ο Πάνος ο Παναγιώτου, βοήθησε αυτή την προσπάθεια και πραγματικά τον ευχαριστώ. Είναι εδώ και η Αλεξία, από ό,τι μας ακούει. Και προχωρούμε λοιπόν προς αυτή την προσπάθεια. Πριν λίγο πάνω στο γραφείο μου, είχαμε την ευκαιρία μαζί με την Μαρίνα και τον Μάριο και τον Γιώργο να δούμε το πρώτο προϊόν το οποίο βγήκε από το Πανεπιστήμιο Κύπρου, από το project Χαρουπόδασος. Είναι η ζυβανή από το χαρούπι. Είναι ένα εξαιρετικό προϊόν, το οποίο είμαι σίγουρος ότι θα έχει ένα καταπληκτικό μέλλον. Θα ακολουθήσουν πάρα πολλά άλλα. Άρα λοιπόν, το πανεπιστήμιο αυτό είναι, η καινοτομία αυτό είναι η προσπάθεια της δημιουργίας του καινούριου. Σας ευχαριστώ και καλώς ορίσατε και πάλι, Μαρίνα.
Ευχαριστούμε, κύριε Πρίτανη, ο καθηγητής πληροφορικής και διευθυντής του Κέντρου Επιχειρηματικότητας του Πανεπιστημίου Κύπρου, Δόκτωρ Μάριος Δικιάκος, καλείται να προσέλθει τώρα στο βήμα για να μας πει δύο λόγια για τη σημερινή μας προσκεκλημένη. Αμέσως μετά την ομιλία της κυρίας Χατσόπουλος, ο κύριος Δικιάκος θα συντονίσει τη συζήτηση που θα ακολουθήσει, όπου και εσείς βέβαια μπορείτε να λάβετε μέρος. Τα μικρόφωνα είναι μπροστά από το κάθισμά σας και μπορείτε να τα χρησιμοποιήσετε καθ' όλη τη διάρκεια της συζήτησης. Κύριε Δικιάκο, το βήμα δικό σας.
Ευχαριστώ πολύ. Καλησπέρα σας. Η κυρία Μαρίνα Χατσοπούλου είναι επιχειρηματίας και επενδυτικός άγγελος, angel investor. Είναι πρόεδρος του Διοικητικού Συμβουλίου και επενδυτής στην εταιρεία Levitronics Technologies, μια εταιρεία που κατέχει ηγετική θέση παγκοσμίως σε μαγνητικά αιωρούμενες αντλίες. Επίσης είναι διευθύντρια της Inosure, μιας εταιρείας των 250 εκατομμυρίων δολαρίων που ηγείται σε προϊόντα αισθητικής με τεχνολογία laser, καθώς και διευθύντρια και επενδυτικός άγγελος στην Dear Kate, μια εταιρεία που δραστηριοποιείται σε τεχνολογικά προϊόντα μόδας. Είναι μέλος της Συμβουλευτικής Επιτροπής του Nantucket Conference, ένα συνέδριο το οποίο γίνεται κάθε χρόνο στη Μασαχουσέτη και φέρνει κοντά ανθρώπους δημιουργικούς, επιχειρηματίες, επινοητές, επενδυτές, τεχνολόγους και executives. Είναι μέλος της Συμβουλευτικής Επιτροπής του Despandes Center for Technological Innovation στο MIT. Το κέντρο αυτό υποστηρίζει καθηγητές και φοιτητές του MIT στις προσπάθειες να αξιοποιήσουν εμπορικά και επιχειρηματικά τις επινοήσεις και τις τεχνολογικές τους ιδέες. Η Μαρίνα υπήρξε ιδρυτής, διευθύνουσα σύμβουλος και κύριος επενδυτής στην Z Corporation, μια εταιρεία με αποτίμηση 30 εκατομμυρίων δολαρίων κατά τη στιγμή της πώλησής της, με κύρια δραστηριότητα την κατασκευή τρισδιάστατων εκτυπωτών, και διετέλεσε επίσης διευθύντρια του GSI Group, ενός ομίλου των 300 εκατομμυρίων δολαρίων που κατασκευάζει προϊόντα laser, όπως και της Context Holding, μιας εταιρείας με αποτίμηση 100 εκατομμυρίων δολαρίων που δραστηριοποιείται στην κατασκευή σαρωτών. Ήταν επενδυτικός άγγελος και διευθύντρια της εταιρείας T-Forte, η οποία πωλήθηκε στην Sara Lee στα τέλη του 2011. Έχει σπουδάσει στο Πανεπιστήμιο Brown και έχει κάνει μεταπτυχιακά στο MIT. Η Μαρίνα είναι ένα χαρακτηριστικό παράδειγμα αυτού που η Άννα Λί Σαξίνιαν, οικονομική γεωγράφος και καθηγήτρια στο Πανεπιστήμιο της Καλιφόρνιας στο Berkeley, αποκαλεί οι νέοι αργοναύτες στο ομώνυμο βιβλίο της του 2006, The New Argonauts. Νέοι αργοναύτες είναι μετανάστες ή απόγονοι μεταναστών, οι οποίοι δραστηριοποιούνται σε καινοτόμα κέντρα επιχειρηματικότητας, όπως είναι η Silicon Valley και η Βοστόνη, και διατηρούν παράλληλα σχέσεις, προωθώντας διαπεριφερειακές συνεργασίες με τις χώρες καταγωγής τους. Σύμφωνα με τη Σαξίνιαν, η συνεισφορά των επιχειρηματιών αυτών έχει αποδειχθεί κέρια σημασίας για τη διεθνή επέκταση των βιομηχανιών της τεχνολογίας και της καινοτομίας και για την οικονομική ανάπτυξη στις χώρες καταγωγής τους, και γι' αυτό υπάρχουν συγκεκριμένα οικονομετρικά στοιχεία. Οπότε ευχαριστούμε πολύ τη Μαρίνα που είναι εδώ κοντά μας και την καλώ στο βήμα για να μιλήσει.
I'm going to speak in English, if that's okay. And I have a little bit of jet lag. So I need you all to be really engaged and have a lot of energy and ask lots of questions, okay? Feel free to interrupt at any time. Just raise your hand. This is much more fun if it's interactive than me just lecturing. So let's see. Oh, there we go. So first of all, before we get started, do we have any entrepreneurs in the house? Raise your hand. Oh, great. Do we have any aspiring entrepreneurs? Is this a dream for anyone? Yeah? Yeah? Okay, good. Okay, here we go. So I'm going to tell you my story, then talk about entrepreneurship, some of the key elements to building a successful startup, and then talk about financing the startup, which is one of the biggest hurdles in doing it. And I'll also talk about entrepreneurship here in Cyprus. So my background is I studied pure math and music at Brown University, and then I went to Chase Manhattan Bank and learned about corporate finance for the oil and gas industry. But I always knew I wanted to be an entrepreneur, and I felt I needed more of a technology background. So I went to work at Thermo Electron, which is a technology conglomerate in Boston. And that was great experience. I got very close to operations. I understood a lot of the marketing issues and manufacturing issues related to a technology startup. But what I was really missing at that point, I realized, was a knowledge of technology. So I went to MIT and got my master's in mechanical engineering. And then I felt I needed one more piece, which was management experience. But I applied for jobs to get management experience, and I was told I didn't have any management experience. So I couldn't get the experience without getting the experience. So I decided, okay, it's time to do my own startup. So I looked around for ideas. I didn't have any good ideas. But luckily, at MIT, they have an office called the Technology Licensing Office. And I hope that the University of Cyprus will one day have an office like this. What it does is it pays to patent inventions that are made by the students and the professors. And then it looks for companies and individuals to commercialize those technologies. So it recognizes that often the researchers who are developing a technology may not be the ones to drive its commercialization, although they are critical to its success. So at MIT, just to give you a sense, and I'll talk a little bit more about it, the professor may spend one day a week on their startup and 4 days a week doing research and teaching. So I was introduced to the licensing office, and I saw a dozen amazing technologies that they were looking to commercialize. And one of them was in 3D printing. And this is in 1994, before anybody knew what 3D printing was. And there were two people in the market in what was then called rapid prototyping. It was very expensive equipment that sold for $100,000 to $1 million. And we set out to change all that and make 3D printing something that was affordable and office compatible. Today, as was mentioned, I'm on the board of Cynosure, which is a $340 million public company, and Levitronics Technologies, which is based in Zurich. And I've been a director on other boards, and I'm an investor in startups, both in the United States as well as in Greece, and in some startup funds in Greece. So Z Corporation was an MIT technology. It was an early leader in 3D printing. At that time, in 1994, it was impossible to get venture capital as a hardware company. Everyone was all excited about the internet, and they had no interest in hardware. So we had to bootstrap. We raised money from our board of directors, and we got some corporate investment. And we were very, very focused on profits and cash flow from day one. And this really created a mindset and a culture in how we did everything. And I believe at the end of the day, it was very useful to us. We ended up raising a total of $11 million from angels and strategic corporate investors. But interestingly, at the time we sold the business, we had $9 million in the bank. So we were extremely capital efficient. We didn't need to raise nearly as much money as we did. When we sold, we had $30 million in the bank and 125 employees, mostly based in Boston, but we sold 3D printers around the world, about a half in the US, a quarter in Europe, and a quarter in Asia. And these are parts made on our 3D. We have the only 3D printing technology that can make parts in full color. So the last part of my story is how did I get involved in Greece and Cyprus? So my parents are both of Greek origin from Athens. They came to college in the United States. My father's an entrepreneur. And I was, after I did my startup and everything a couple years ago, I was invited to speak by MIT Enterprise Forum Greece, which runs a conference in Athens in November. It's coming up Saturday, November 5th, this coming Saturday. So I encourage you all to attend. It's a short flight away, and it's very easy to go. Before I went, though, I happened to be invited by the governor of Massachusetts to take a trip to Israel. And I had no preconceptions about Israel whatsoever and no particular connection to Israel. But I went there and I was blown away by Startup Nation. It's incredible what's happening there in terms of entrepreneurship. And for me, the light bulb went off, which is, if they can do it in Israel with missiles coming at them, why can't we do it in Greece and in Cyprus? There's absolutely no reason. Culturally, there are many, many similarities in terms of independent thinking, in terms of a very strong educational, technical education, in terms of a certain scrappiness and ability to get things done, an entrepreneurial mindset. We'll talk about Cyprus, but here in Cyprus, you also have a business-friendly environment. One thing that Israel has done very successful is this Israeli model. So they keep a development team in Israel, and then the CEO will go overseas, let's say to Boston, and set up a forward-looking operation, which is sales and marketing. And that allows, you know, these founders often have very strong ties to the homeland. They're back and forth all the time. There's a Greek company right now based in Boston called Workable. They're being wildly successful, and the founder CEO is doing exactly this. He's going back and forth. He's got a development team in Greece that is working for a fraction of what it would cost if they were based in Silicon Valley, for example, or even in Boston. So he's getting huge leverage by doing that model. So what's the point of entrepreneurship? The point is jobs. Entrepreneurship creates jobs. And I know the situation in Cyprus isn't as bad as it is in Greece, but still, jobs are good. And it provides upward social mobility and economic opportunity. So as opposed to traditional old world jobs, where you are rewarded for who you know and how you know you find your way into a job through connections, or you work your way up through seniority. Entrepreneurship is the great equalizer. It's a meritocracy. If you're good, if you hustle, you're smart, you build a good team, and you make it work, you will be successful. It also provides incredible independence. And I say this as a woman with four children. Being an entrepreneur with four tiny kids provided incredible independence that I would never have had in a traditional job, because I could build the world's schedule around me as opposed to the reverse. In today's environment, given where a lot of the development is taking place, which is software, you can actually build a very successful business with small amounts of capital. That's less true in hardware businesses like what I was doing, but in software, you can really do that. And so there's a huge amount of potential without requiring a lot of capital on day one. So I want to give you a sense for the background, where I'm coming from. So I got my master's in mechanical engineering from MIT, where there is a very strong culture of entrepreneurship. There are 30,000 active companies from MIT alumni. And these today are creating 5 million jobs or $2 trillion in annual revenues. And just to give you a sense of scale, this would be the 10th largest economy in the world if it were its own country. So it's a hugely entrepreneurial mindset. And it's very much, you get out there, there are a million different programs, and you have to figure out what works and be successful. The 100K competition has created over 60 companies worldwide, valued at $10.5 billion. So some of the programs that MIT has to promote entrepreneurship, some of these are very new. One of the newest programs is called the Sandbox. So any student can go and apply for a grant of up to $1,000 to do basically anything entrepreneurial. You may say, I want to make puppets and I need a sewing machine, and you go and you'll get it. The bar is very low for this. And it's to get students to explore entrepreneurship. Then there are grants, and this is what we've been discussing with the University of Cyprus, is to build a program similar to the Deshpande Center, where there are grants of $25,000 to $250,000 to get research out of the lab and to a position where it can be funded by venture capital. And you might say, well, what's the big deal? Is that so hard? There is a big funding gap there where venture capitalists need some of the technology to be de-risked. But a lot of times there are no more grants available to get the technology to the next phase, to the next milestone. So this funding is extremely critical. And the other thing that the Deshpande Center does, which we were talking about earlier today, is connect people. So it has open events where the entrepreneurs can display their technology, promote it, discuss it, and get visibility within the whole entrepreneurial ecosystem in Boston so that they can get access to venture capitalists and other partners, business partners and customers who might be interested in their technology. So that connection is also extremely important. And here, when you're in Cyprus, that's incredibly important so that you're not operating just within the confines of people here, but actually getting full world exposure. There's the 100K competition, which awards money to the winners of this big competition. Then there's the Venture Mentoring Service. And what that is, it's often retired entrepreneurs who help entrepreneurs in their startups. I hope this water is for me. And then the Technology Licensing Office, which I already described to you. And what happens is they pay the patents, and then the companies, when they spin out, pay a royalty and fees back to MIT. And the interesting thing is we at Z Corporation went through the licensing office, and they said to us day one, our primary goal is to disseminate MIT technology. It's not to make money. We do make money, but that's not our primary mission. Our primary mission is to disseminate MIT technology. We want to see it out in the world. So one thing MIT does not do is they won't give out their license, their technology to someone who's just going to pay them a lot of money for it and sit on the technology or squash it so that they can promote their own technology. They want to see this technology out into the world. Related to MIT is an organization called MIT Enterprise Forum. And MIT Enterprise Forum Greece is the organization that's having the conference on Saturday. They're a global organization that has offices all over the world, 23 offices. And their focus is on early stage entrepreneurship, and they're trying to turn ideas into world-class companies. They have events for inspiration and for networking. And what we've done in Boston is create a diaspora group of technology entrepreneurs in Boston that have a connection to Greece. They're either Greeks, Greek Americans, lovers of Greece. They have some sort of a connection. And we would love to bring Cyprus as well into this fold because we think that this bridge to the technology entrepreneurship ecosystem in Boston is extremely valuable. And so we've organized events where we've had entrepreneurs from Greece come over and pitch to this audience for potential investment or just for education purposes to find partners. And it's been extremely fruitful so far. There's also the conference I mentioned and a startup competition, which is starting now. If you're an entrepreneur, you should look at this. There are international partners who act as mentors and as judges in the competition. And then the winners get global visibility through MIT Technology Review, which is a globally distributed magazine about technology. The finalists in the contest do a one-week boot camp at MIT. And excuse me. And there are sponsorships available. For anybody who's interested. So the first thing you need to do when you're doing a startup is have an idea. And I really recommend, before you get too far along in your idea, is to take a piece, just a little napkin, and write down some numbers. Like, to build a sizable business, let's say like a $10 million business, how many units do you need to sell? And this is extremely important because sometimes people don't really think about that. They're like, well, I want to make a cookie business. Okay, how much are you going to sell a cookie for? How many cookies are you going to have to make to build a $10 million business? Not to say it's not doable, But just think through the numbers. Excuse me. Then you have to think about the time required to get to commercialization and the investment needed to get to revenues. And that's an extremely critical thing. If you're doing something like hardware, like what we did, that was a 2-year development cycle, and it was a couple million dollars. And so then you have to think, you know, do I have access to that pool of capital? And then you also want to think about the next big, the first big milestone is a paying customer. Not somebody who says it's a great idea, a paying customer. You need someone to part with their money. That's a big milestone. The second big milestone is profitability, because until you're profitable, you don't really know if you have a business. So you need to budget that out. You're going to be wrong, but that's okay. You'll be revising this as you go along. The other is pricing. Pricing is absolutely critical, and most entrepreneurs price their product too low. And seriously too low, very much too low. And they have no idea all the other expenses that are going to be involved in terms of manufacturing, in terms of R&D, and in terms of sales and marketing. At Z Corporation, we were blessed. We had this vision of coming out with a product at $20,000. And luckily, before we launched our product, the two big players in the market on the high end that I talked about announced that they were going to come out with products at $60,000. So we went and examined them, and we said, wow, we're 10 times faster than they are, so we should be able to compete okay. And our chairman said, if we're 10 times faster, why would we price it cheaper than them? If they're pricing at $60,000, let's price it at $60,000. We can always lower the price later. It's very hard to raise your price. So we said, all right, we'll do that for a few weeks, and then we can always bring it down. We priced it at $60,000, and here we are. That was in 1996, so we're 20 years later. $60,000, it turns out, is a sweet spot in the marketplace. It's a place that is actually very easy to get funding from companies. It doesn't require a huge level of approval. And it turns out it was much more expensive to sell the product, to educate the market about this product than we had expected. We would have gone out of business if we had priced it at $20,000. The other is talk with customers. I don't know why. It's so hard for entrepreneurs to talk to customers. You have to do this. You have to do this very, very early on, because no matter what you think, you are wrong. And it's only after you talk to 20 customers that you'll find out how and why you're wrong. So you need to know, does anyone care about your idea? And don't worry. I know you're worried. Someone's going to steal your idea. If it's that easy to steal your idea, trust me. They're going to steal it anyway. It doesn't matter. You'll have a much harder time getting anyone to listen to your idea than you will getting them to steal it. The other is, how much are they willing to pay for it? Do they actually have a real problem? And are they willing to pay money for this? How big is their pain today? And then a very important thing that a lot of entrepreneurs don't think about is, if I don't do this, who's better positioned to do this? Because oftentimes there's somebody that is perfectly positioned to do it. Let me give you an example. Let's say you wanted to do some kind of search engine optimization or whatever. Well, Google's out there. I mean, how well funded is Google? They're pretty well funded. And they have huge resources, huge teams on research and development. I would never in a billion years go into a market that is in Google's sweet spot. Number one, if they're not doing it already, it's a bad idea. And number two, if I do pursue it because I decide that they're stupid, which is a pretty silly assumption, and I go and I prove that it's a good idea, they'll take it in a nanosecond and do a much better job selling and marketing it, developing it, than I will do. So you're much better off to find a market where you are the best one positioned to do it. And I'll give you an example for that. When we were doing 3D printing, we were the only powder-based technology using inkjet printing technology. We were the only ones in the world using this technology. We knew more than anybody in the world about our technology. So, and in fact, we saw this because we tried to develop partnerships with experts in materials development, and we were educating them the whole time, and they didn't come up with anything new. This was a huge multi-billion-dollar corporation we dealt with, and they couldn't come up with anything new, and it's not surprising. We had scientists who had been working at MIT for 5 years before we had even started the company. So our team knew much more about that than anybody else in the market. So it's worth taking a moment to think, am I the best one? Are we as a team the best ones to pursue this technology? I just want to say a great idea is necessary, but it's absolutely not sufficient. A great idea is only the start of your adventure, but there's a lot more to come that will determine your ultimate success. So the first thing is intellectual property, and everyone knows about patents. You want to do patents for things that are very difficult to invent and easy to copy. So for example, we patented our process, because our process was something that took a lot of time to develop, but once you saw the answer and we delivered you the machine, it was very easy to copy. The same with our materials. We patented our materials because you could do a chemical analysis on our materials, and so what took us years to develop would be somewhat easy to copy, although not entirely. So we also used trade secrets and know-how. And those were incredibly important. So on our materials development, for example, we patented entire classes of materials. But what we didn't have to inform the public about in the patents was very specific details, like which supplier we used. And what we found was we would get different results based on the suppliers of some of our ingredients. So we kept some of these things as trade secrets, and we were very careful about not sharing them with anyone. Market. You want a market that's big enough. I happen to favor niche kind of markets, but when I talk about niche, I don't mean, 100 people. It means it's not a ginormous market that all the big incumbents are going after, like, the next new great engine for your car. I find it hard to believe that a small team is going to make the next new great engine. I mean, it could happen, but probably the car manufacturers are going to have better resources to pursue something like that. Try to sell the product before it even exists. So when I say talk to customers, you can talk to customers and they'll tell you, they might tell you, oh, that's a really nice idea, but it's very different than when you try to actually sell it. And I've had this experience where I've gone to trade shows and said, here's our 3D printed part. Would you buy our 3D printer? And in the early days, people said, your parts are crappy. No, I wouldn't. And that was very important. It guided our development as we went along. But it's also important because oftentimes customers can fund early development. We had a customer in Japan who wanted a color 3D printer. Up until that point, I had told our team who really wanted to develop a color 3D printer, I said, look guys, we don't have 3D color data, so there's nothing to print. Without the data, you can't print it. So forget about it. First, we need to find a market for it. After we find the market, we'll develop it. And luckily, this university came and said, would you develop it for us? And they gave us money to develop it. So our engineers were happy, we developed it, and then we created the market from there. I said, don't worry about people stealing your ideas. And then the other thing is, and I know this feels incredibly arrogant, but we did it and you can do it. If you have a proprietary technology that nobody else has, you can do this. Go to your customers who want your product and tell them if they want to get in line for your first deliveries, they have to pay you a 20% deposit upfront when they sign the purchase order. And then you'll put them in line to get the first machines. You can even give them an exclusive for a certain period of time if that's valuable to them. But key to all of this is a clear value proposition. So the first thing you have to do is build a table like what I show here, where you have your product and the competitor's products lined up. And don't tell me you don't have any competition, because you do. Your competition is whatever is out there today. Maybe it's inferior for 100 different reasons. Maybe it's a totally different way of doing it. But people are doing something today. And so you need to put that up there. Even if they're doing nothing, put that up there. And now compare. Compare what are the benefits of what you're offering versus what is being offered today, so that you can use this as the crux for your sales proposition when you're trying to sell your product. And this is really important. You and the team need to know what makes you completely different than anything else out there. You can have a lot of disadvantages. At Z Corp, for example, we had some major disadvantages over the competition, but we had three huge advantages. We were 10 times faster. So that means for 3D printing a part like this, you'd get it in an hour instead of tomorrow. Huge difference, right? I mean, do you want the part today or do you want it tomorrow? You want it today. We could make parts in full color, and our materials were significantly less expensive, about 1/10 the cost of our competitors' materials. So this would be like $30 maybe of material, $20, something like that, of materials. So these were three big advantages. Everyone on our team could tell you what those advantages were. We weren't going to tell you our disadvantages so much, but we could tell you what our advantages were very clearly. And that's extremely important, because if you can't distinguish yourself from everything that's out there, and don't tell me there's room for Coke and Pepsi, that's not setting yourself up for success. You really want to be very different than anything that's out there, because the reality is most startups fail, and that's okay, and that's a great learning experience, and you shouldn't worry about failure. Most entrepreneurs have had failures in their past or failures in their future, and that's all good. But if you want to be successful, if you want to be one out of the 100, then you want to try to put all the odds in your favor. Competition. Competition is good. And I'll tell you, when in our early days, we didn't have a lot of competition. And so we were selling against nothing, against people not buying 3D printers. What they were doing is looking at their computer screen, and they were saying, that's good enough. And we were saying, no, that's not good enough. You need to 3D print a part. And we're going to show you how your design process will be better. You'll find flaws, you'll reduce your manufacturing cost, and you'll gain revenues by reaching the market sooner. Those are very difficult arguments. We loved selling against the competition, where we could say, no problem, we're the same price, we're 10 times faster, full color, much lower material cost. That's an easy sell. So the other thing we found is having competition that was well-funded. They weren't huge companies like Google or Apple. I wouldn't have wanted to compete against them. They were smaller. But they had sales and marketing resources that were about 3 times ours. So they could spend money educating the market on why people should be using 3D printing. And once they educated the market, then the customer would go and say, yeah, we want to get a 3D printer. Now let's look and see which 3D printer we want to buy. And we were very happy to compete once we were invited in. The hard part for us was the expense of educating the customer on the front end. And often that took about a year. It was a very, very expensive, time-consuming process. You want to see, you don't want competition, as I say, that's huge. And you want to see who is perfectly positioned in terms of customers or technology. So if there's someone else that's more perfectly positioned than you, you better understand why haven't they done it already. Go talk to them, ask them why they haven't done it. They may have tried to do it and it failed. And it may have failed for a very good reason. There may be the market doesn't want it for whatever reason. You also want to know what is going to keep them from entering the market after you're successful. Because you don't want to go in and prove the market and then have them come and steal it away from you. And that may be as simple as you have core patents. That's what we did. We had core patents to the basic technology, which prevented anyone from stealing our technology. And then you want to know, will they have an unfair advantage or will you? So at Z Corp, we had an unfair advantage. We had the team that had been developing this technology at MIT for 5 years before we even founded the company. They were experts in all of this. So we had a huge advantage of time. We had patents that were protecting us. We had the MIT name on the patents, which helped us. And so we felt that we were, and we were also, we had a very creative, out-of-the-box entrepreneurial team. So it was very well suited for what we were trying to do, which was come up with ideas out of the air for what materials would work to make a 3D printed part. It turns out large corporations are excellent at making incremental improvements and at sales and marketing and distribution, but they're really bad at innovation. So we were very well positioned relative to the competition. And as I say, the important thing is product differentiation. You want to know what is the one thing that makes yours significantly better than everything else, and what is it that you have as a company that makes you uniquely positioned to do this? Team is the number one most important factor for investors. So when any investor is looking to invest in a company, the most important thing is who is the team. And when you're pulling your team together, I'd like to make some strong recommendations to you. Number one, know family or friends, because it can be a very difficult road, and it's very unlikely that your best friend happens to be the perfect person for this. And there are also going to be some difficult moments, and you want your friend to be the person you go to when you're pissed off at your team, and you need someone to go to. And if you have this dual relationship at work, I'm not saying don't be friendly with the people you work with, but the other thing is you want a team that's complementary to yourself. You don't want a team that is your mirror image, because then you're just replicating the same skills and strengths. What you want to do is fill in the holes. You want to take these outrageously talented creative people, like what we had at Z Corp. The two engineers out of MIT were like the craziest people you've ever met. I can't even tell you how crazy they are. They made explosions in the office. They never wore shoes. It was a big mess. They were such creative thinkers, though. They thought of things that nobody else could have thought of. And we never tried to fit them into a box. One of them, I don't think he ever showed up in the office at 9 a.m. in his entire tenure at Z Corp. We had to tell him to put on shoes for meetings when we went. He slept at the office most nights. I mean, he was really crazy, but he was absolutely brilliant, and he came up with stuff that nobody else could do. So instead of trying to get them to conform to some image that we had, I tried that, by the way, and I failed. It didn't work. So I'm coming to you at this with some experience. Instead of trying to get them to be what we imagined, we just filled in the holes. So we found managers of the engineering teams. We filled in what we needed, what they couldn't do, because what they brought to the table was so unique and so different than what we could hire. Set up founders' equity from day one. Before you get too far along, decide how you're going to split up the pie. This is one thing I see at MIT with the teams, is they wait too long, and then there are certain expectations, and people think that they're going to get a certain percentage of the pie. You should discuss that very early on. And you should also make sure that people's equity is earned over time, because typically what will happen is there'll be a small team out of university, let's say 3-4 people, and they say, great, we'll all be partners, we'll split it up evenly. But then after 6 months, somebody gets a job offer at Google and they go off. Well, the other team, the rest of the team, is still there working 12-hour days to get this thing off the ground. And this guy's at Google making $100,000 a year. He shouldn't get 25% of the equity. So it should be something that's earned over time. And so if somebody leaves, they only get a smaller piece of the equity. Leverage your network to find people. We did that in a big way. I would go to cocktail parties and say, do you know a software engineer? And it's amazing because if it comes through your network, there's a lot of filtering that has taken place. So you don't realize that, but someone who they know someone is going to be a much better candidate than a random email off the street. But make sure you don't hire someone you can't fire. Don't hire Yaya, okay? It's not a good idea. At the end of the day, sometimes you got to make very difficult decisions, and you can't be, in a position where you can't let someone go. Because sometimes, for whatever reason, it just doesn't work out. It's not a fit, and you need to be able to take action. You should have a hiring philosophy. We had one, and I'm not saying ours is the best, but just to give you a sense, our philosophy was to hire very hungry young people who were very smart, and they had been very successful in whatever they had done to date, but that didn't mean that they had experience doing what we were asking them to do. In fact, a lot of times we didn't want them to be experienced because we were doing something slightly different than what had been done before, and we didn't want them to be biased by their prior experience. And you'll see this. There are companies like JetBlue and Southwest in the United States who will not hire from within the airline industry because that culture is so corrupt. It's such a bad culture that they don't want those people in their companies. So part of why you hire is culture. We wanted people with a lot of fire in their belly, people who had something to prove that didn't already have a big success under their belt. This was gonna be their big success. The most difficult issue as a manager is, okay, you've got employees who are really bad, especially the ones who poison the culture, you gotta get rid of them. The ones who are complaining all the time, negative attitude, those people have to go. I don't care how capable they are. You sit them down, you try to get them to change, but if they don't change, they need to go because that will ruin your culture. But then you have the employees who are okay and they're just not superstars. And that's fine if you have 1,000 employees. There's space for those kind of people. But in a small startup, if you have 4 people on your team, you don't really have space for okay. And those are hard to let go, but you're not really doing them a favor by keeping them on if it's not a great fit. And one of my favorite stories is my husband once talked to someone who worked for him and said, you know, this company isn't really a good fit for you. It's a very technology-based company. This wasn't at our company, but it was at a different company. And he said, we're a very technology-based company and you're not a technology person. I highly recommend you find another job. And the guy did, and he's like a billionaire today. So it was like the greatest gift to this guy to find out where he fit. And everyone has a place in this world. It doesn't mean that it's in your company. So we all make mistakes. You have to own them. That's the hardest thing to do. And make change right away. Don't take time. Don't stick your head in the sand. Articulate your direction and stay focused. And for us, with this team of crazy engineers out of MIT, staying focused was one of the biggest challenges we had because these guys wanted to do everything. They were going in a million different directions, and we had to just keep reining them in. So I talked a little bit about culture, and that's really set at the top. We had a culture that all that matters is the results. It's not about FaceTime. I don't care if you leave early. I don't care. We didn't keep track of vacation time. You can go, do whatever you want, but you're accountable for your results. And don't come crying and giving me some excuse for why you couldn't do what you wanted. Time to market is absolutely critical and urgent. This is not a time for kafedaki. This is not time for balance in your life. This is one of the biggest struggles. This isn't something that you're necessarily gonna do for the rest of your life. This could be, it's not something that you should expect to turn around in a year or 2 years. Do not expect that. If you're in it, you're in it. It's probably gonna be 10 years, but it's not forever. And during that time, you need to give it everything you have. And these are very long days. It's working weekends. It's killing yourself. It's a rush from the moment you wake up till you fall down in bed at night. You're in a rush. You're literally, I mean, I remember at Z Corp running down the hall, like to make things happen, because I had so many things on my list of things to do that day. I had to run to get it done. The 80-20 rule, so perfection is your enemy. And I know that this isn't something you're necessarily used to hearing, especially in a university environment. But the problem with perfection is it takes too long. And you are wrong. Whatever you're developing is not quite right. And the only way you're going to know that is to get it into the market and get feedback from the customers. And the customers can't give you feedback and an idea. This is one thing that shocked me in talking to customers. Customers are not visionary at all. It's unbelievable how not visionary they are. But when you put something in their hands and you say, use this, then their feedback is extremely important. Now they can tell you, no, you've missed the mark here. This is how you have to do it. Or this is how you have to sell. Or this is who you should be selling to. And it's only by having a product in their hand that they can give you that meaningful feedback. So you need to be on a mission to get that product out there, even though you know it's not perfect. And make concrete milestones and deliver on those milestones. So we had a monthly dashboard, and I highly recommend having this. And you can have this dashboard at every stage of your development, even pre-revenue. But this is what we had after we were in revenues. This is actually one of our years. So you keep track of things like your average sale price. You want to make sure that your sale price is where you want it to be, that people aren't giving too many discounts out on the street, that your revenues, you know, you want to see every month that your revenues are growing, your gross margin is where you want it to be, where your net income is. Cash is the most important number. If there's only one number you look at, you need to know where your cash is, because companies run out of business when they run out of cash. That's as simple as that. You can have the greatest technology, the most amazing team. You can be on the mission and so close to having it. But if you run out of cash, you're dead in the water and it doesn't matter. And then we kept track of things like service calls because we wanted to obviously reduce our service calls. And so we wanted to track it over time. You know, if you don't track something, you can't improve on it. And then repeat sales were extremely important for us. We wanted to know that people were coming back and buying more material and buying more machines. The board of directors is very important. We had a passionate group of board of directors that really believed in us and our mission. They drank the Kool-Aid, as we say. And they actually provided funding for us through several rounds. Find a mentor. Before the board of directors, I recommend finding a mentor with relevant success. And it's really important that you find a mentor who's not just going to pat you on the back, but who's going to tell you what you don't want to hear. And listen to them. Find investors who understand your business, who believe in it, and have deep pockets to invest. Do not take money. Don't take, you know, someone's last $10,000 and that's going to be their kid's money for college or something. You don't want that money. Like, honestly, don't take it. Even you may have friends begging you for money to take their money, but if that's money that's extremely important to them, that will weigh on you. And you need to be able to make coherent business decisions. And you need deep pockets because inevitably during a startup, there are going to be very rocky times and you're going to go through a dry spell and it's going to take more than you thought to get this product out in the market and to get to profitability. So you need someone who's going to be there through several rounds, who's already invested in you and can be there to invest more. Find missing areas of expertise and fill those roles. So when you're pulling together a board of directors, I could tell you every one of our board of directors in one word what they brought to the table. One was a lawyer. One had funding experience taking companies public and through IPO and acquisition. Another one knew the market. I mean, so I could tell you specifically what they were bringing to the table. Do not bring your friends on the board. Do not bring your colleagues on the board just because you want to be nice. First of all, you can't get, it's very hard to get rid of a board member. So you're going to be stuck with them. So make sure you've done a little bit of vetting on them, but they can be extremely valuable if they're bringing something to the table. Start with a small board. You only need 3 people on a board to start, and then you can grow from there as you need people. And use your board. Don't just report to them. So one thing we did is it was very important to us to get feedback from our board, and often we left a meeting changing direction entirely from where we had been walking into the meeting. And the way to do the problem is what you don't recognize is that your board of directors isn't living and breathing your problems day to day. So you need to take the time to really think about a problem that you're facing, a question, and articulate what the question is. And half the problem is articulating that question because you don't even know what the question is. But if you take the time before your board meeting and really think about what is the biggest strategic question I'm facing now? So for example, do I want to sell directly to consumers with my medical device, or do I want to sell it to hospitals and have the hospitals sell it? Do I want it to be reimbursed by insurance companies or have customers buy it directly themselves? Strategic questions like that. And then provide the background information that the board needs to have a useful conversation, and then have an unstructured discussion for an hour or two about that question. And then you get really meaningful feedback from the board. But it requires a lot of work ahead of time and not just winging it at the last minute. Financing. So I'd like to talk to you about how do you fund your business. And obviously, it's very dependent on where you are. So I'm going to give you a little bit of a Boston-centric view of the world. But in 3 major categories, there are angels, venture capital, and strategic investors. And venture capital can be in the form of equity, it usually is, or also debt. We had some venture debt. And then strategic investors can be in the form of equity, so corporate investors that have an interest in your success. It can be R&D contracts, where it's corporate investors who want to take the development to the next stage. So they don't necessarily want a piece of the action. They don't need equity, but they're willing to pay for the development. And then maybe there's an arrangement where they have an exclusivity for a period of time after you've developed it, or some other arrangement. And then the last is customer deposits. As I mentioned before, that's a great way to fund your company. So angels are individuals or groups which meet monthly. So if it's a group, they often will meet monthly, and entrepreneurs will come and pitch to them. And then they'll share the due diligence. So within the group, someone will say, yeah, I really like that idea. I'll spearhead the due diligence, and then 10 of us will invest. Or there are individual angel investors like myself, who I just go on my own, and people pitch to me and I invest. So these can be small investments. Actually, they can be lower than 25. They can be like $10,000, up to $500,000, even $1 million. There are usually fewer control provisions. Angel investment is highly desirable from an entrepreneurial perspective. If you can get it, usually the terms are better. Seed investments are often made in the form of convertible debt. So what that means is if you're a very early startup, let's say you're 2 guys and an idea, and you say, we've got this great idea, and we've done a little bit of development, we have a proof of concept, and we want to start a company, and we need $1 million. Okay, so what's the value? 2 guys and an idea. How do you value that? Like, it could be anything. And they say, well, we're going to be worth $1 billion in 5 years. Yeah, maybe. Maybe you are. We'll know a lot more in a year, right? So you're going to need another $5 million next year. So why don't we punt on the valuation? And we'll say, let's meet again in a year. I'll give you the $1 million today. And that $1 million, if this company doesn't do well, you pay me back my $1 million with a certain interest. But nobody wants that to happen. That's a bad outcome. If things go well, Now, at the next valuation, when we raise $5 million, my $1 million will go in, but I get a discount of pricing. I'll get a 20% discount. So for, in other words, because I took the risk and invested the $1 million a year before the next round of $5 million, I will get 20% more shares than the guys investing later. So this is a nice way to postpone this very thorny issue of valuation at the earliest stages. And this is very commonly done. The disadvantage of angels is that they may not have the capital or appetite to invest through multiple rounds. So you may get a nice group together, you may cobble together $500,000 and you're all excited and you're good to go, but guess what? In a year, you need more money. Now you have to start from scratch. So if you're in a kind of a business that's gonna need a lot of capital, you might as well start with venture capital. So venture capital is, these are large funds, huge funds that have a lot of capital to put to work. And what they'll tell you is that this, it's the same amount of work for them to make a $100,000 investment as a $100 million investment. And so they would just as soon make a large investment than a small investment. So they invest a lot. They might invest $1 million to $25 million. The VCs have a very different business model than the angels. So they expect that out of, let's say, a dozen investments that they make, they want one unicorn. So they might expect out of the dozen that most of them are going to fail. A few of them will be what they call the living dead. So they're like, okay, they might grow a little bit, but you know, they're not in it for 3x return. They're in it for the huge return, 30x to 100x return. They want a board seat. They want control of your company. They have many terms that control your ability to finance your company. They can fire you as CEO if they control the board. So you're really handing over a lot of control when you bring on venture capital. But the nice part is you have access to a large pool of capital so they can invest through multiple rounds. They also carry a tremendous amount of credibility, especially if you're a company, a startup based in Cyprus. If you can get a Boston VC to invest money in you, that gives you a real, some real recognition. The disadvantage is there is a tremendous pressure to grow fast, and that can be good or it can be bad, and it, you have to know your business. So for example, in our business, 3D printing, this wasn't something that we could just grow by throwing money at it. We had to educate the market. What you see today as this huge discovery of 3D printing started over 30 years ago. It took so long and so much money to educate the market. You could have, we could have wasted tens and tens of millions of dollars throwing money at the problem, but it just took time. And so it wouldn't have generated a return on that investment. However, there are other companies, take Uber for example. Uber's raised a ton of money, but Uber knows exactly what it needs to do. It's got a business model that it knows how to replicate, and what it needs is money to just put on the gas and go faster. They can generate a return on their investment because they know exactly what to do and they just need to do it. So you just need to know your business and you need to know if you need a lot of money and if that money is gonna be generate a good return. Strategic investors are corporate investors with an interest in your success. So they could be customers. We had a customer invest in our company. We also had a distributor, a Japanese distributor, invest in our company. Or it can be a supplier who wants to supply you a critical piece of your technology, and so they want you to be successful because they want to sell more supplies to you. An advantage of strategic investment is you usually give up very little control. I mean, with ours, I gave them a tiny little paragraph once a year with our numbers, and that was it. And they didn't have a board seat, no control. You often get access to a large partner who can help you grow your business. And it validates your business to have an outside investor, and it gives you credibility. The disadvantage is it may limit your ability to bring in partners or acquisition candidates who are their competitors. So this is something that you definitely, it doesn't mean it's a deal breaker, but you should definitely worry about it. So if you are a company and you sell caramel syrup to Coke and Pepsi, and now you take an equity investment from Coke, probably you're gonna lose Pepsi as a client. So you just need to worry about that. And then the other thing is, you want to make sure that you're not going to be giving them information that you would rather keep under your belt. So you don't want to be, if it's a customer, let's say, you don't want them to start thinking, instead of buying 3D printers from Z Corp, why don't we develop our own 3D printers? In our case, we didn't really have a big risk of that. But, you know, you could be supplying something where your customer could develop it. And so you just want to be worried about that. When you're pitching to investors, make sure your pitch is very clear and simple. Number one thing, what do you sell? Before you start telling me how great it is, how big the market is, how wonderful you are, what is it? So if it's a physical product, show me the product. If it's too big, show me a photograph of the product. If it's software, show me your screen. I want to see what it is, because people love using all these fancy terms, and what they don't understand is that they're not communicating what it is that they're actually doing. Forget about the quick flip. Don't tell me you're going to sell your business in 2 years to Google for $1 billion. Don't tell me another company just like yours just sold for $1 billion. That's, you know, not neither here nor there. If you're going to be successful, you need to build a successful business. Acquirers want to buy a successful business. So building something only for sale is a very dangerous situation. You don't necessarily want to do that. And find investors who have invested with success in related businesses, because they'll understand your business really well. They'll ask very good questions. And one thing I found is that pitching should not be a waste of your time. If you are pitching to smart investors, even if they don't invest, they'll ask very good probing questions, and you should be taking notes, because a lot of their questions are very deep questions about your value proposition and about your business that you should be thinking about and worrying about. And even if you have a nice, easy answer for them, and that's fine for that moment, make sure you're actually thinking about it, and because they could be onto something. Considerations for you are capital versus control. If you're going to need to raise a lot of money anyway, you're probably going to lose control anyway, so that may not be a big issue. But if you can do it with a little amount of capital, you'll retain more ownership over the business, control over the business, and ultimately, you won't need it to be as big a success, and you can have a very successful outcome for you as an entrepreneur with less capital. But it depends. If you are a new search engine in 1985 competing against Google, you need to raise a lot of money or you're in the water, dead. So there's some businesses you have no choice. You have to raise a lot of money, you have to grow fast, or you're dead. There are other businesses like ours where we would have just thrown that money away. It would have been useless. You're going to trade off growth versus profitability. That's a very difficult decision you always have to make. You want to drive to profitability as quickly as you can, but if you can grow faster, you're always making that trade-off, because growth is obviously very valuable. So one thing I just want to leave you with, there's a lot of discussion, especially if you spend any time in Silicon Valley. All anyone talks about are the unicorns. Most businesses are not unicorns, and you can make very good money as an entrepreneur without building a unicorn, as long as you don't take in too much investment. So you want to be realistic about how big your business can be and match your investment to how big that business could be. Don't mess up a business to look pretty. Don't plan on acquisition. Many issues are outside of your control completely. Don't sell into a buyer's market. Just hold on. Don't put your startup in a situation where you have to sell. I talked to a guy who said he had 2 weeks of cash left in the bank, and he's in a negotiation with a buyer. I mean, you're in a terrible negotiating position. Don't put yourself in that position. Build a strong business, and acquirers will come. They may not come today, but they will come. And the good news is, if they don't, you don't care. Moments of crisis. How are we on time? Should I wrap up? Am I? Okay. We've had some moments of crisis. This is part of the game. Get ready for them. We had competition come out right before our product launch. After we got to revenues, we had a month of zero revenues, which is heartbreaking. We tripled our burn rate. We hired all these engineers, tripled our burn rate right before our sales fell off during the economic crisis. But guess what? Failure is information. Use it to your advantage. It's all good. If you use it, you can pivot, you can deal with it. Just don't stick your head in the sand. Some minor things doing business with Americans. I hope all of you will come with your startup and visit Boston. It's an incredibly startup-friendly place. It's a great place to set up headquarters for your business. If you get an email, respond immediately. Within a few hours or at the latest within the day. Plan ahead. If you're coming to Boston, set up your meetings ahead of time. It's very hard to get meetings at the last minute. Follow through on whatever you say you're going to do. So when I'm meeting with entrepreneurs, I always ask them, what's your next milestone? And then the next time we meet, I ask them if they met the milestone. So keep track of that. Network, and I should change this. I noticed Greeks and Cypriots use Facebook a lot. So if that's the custom, that's fine. But if you want to get plugged into the American ecosystem, LinkedIn is really the way to go. In the US, you use Facebook more for personal and LinkedIn for professional. But whatever you do, if you're using Facebook professionally, that's fine. But don't put your bathing suit picture on the front. Like, you know, if you're going to use it for business, have it be a little bit more professional. I don't know what the thing is with misses, but Greeks especially use misses a lot. But in the States, you use Mr. and Ms. But generally, you go to first name basically immediately. As soon as you meet someone, you just go to their first name. But you never use misses under any circumstances. Entrepreneurship in Cyprus. So the good news is you're in a place, and this is really exciting about being here in Cyprus, that has political, economic, and legislative stability. It's free of bureaucracy, and it's business friendly. You have a great education system, so people are well educated. You have to go global early. You have to bootstrap to early profitability. That's what builds a strong business. That's all good. You have access to capital, to human capital. The fact that you have access to this pool of well-educated talent is enormous. You don't realize what an advantage that is. We had so much trouble hiring people. It's very, very hard in Boston, New York, and Silicon Valley, because as soon as you hire someone good, Google comes and pays them three times as much. Think bigger. Commercialize university of research. Don't just do your next social mobile app. Think out of the box. Take something that's difficult, that's going to take 2 years of development to develop. That's where the gold is hidden. And that's one thing, it's going to take a lot longer to do, but there's tremendous amount of value creation in that process. So look around, understand, talk to customers, understand what are problems you see that could be solved by innovation, and try to solve those problems. So my parting words, this is our startup. So you can see me in the short hair, and those are my twin girls who are now in college. I used to bring them into the office. We had a nursery set up in the office, actually. Entrepreneurship is an amazing adventure. Controlling your own destiny is enriching and fulfilling. You have to persevere. As I say, there's no life balance. This isn't a Disney movie. But as you go along your journey, enjoy it, because it's an amazing, magical experience. Celebrate every milestone you hit and have fun along the way, because it's a great time. Thank you for having me.
So, any questions from the audience?
Yes.
So, I'm just sure we've met before.
Yes.
So, you mentioned not to go against the big incumbents, but the guys from Google, they went to Yahoo first, right? The guys who set up Google, they went to Yahoo, and then Yahoo set up Huawei, but they persisted.
Yeah.
And they basically set up something that overtook the incumbents.
Yeah. They had something that was significantly better. And so if you're going to take them on, you better be sure that you have something that's significantly better. And they did an extraordinary job on execution. But they had something that they could protect, and Yahoo couldn't just take it and run. So they had something very novel and innovative. If you're in that position, and they're a very unique team as well. So, but if you can do it, yes.
I'll go with a maybe more difficult question. So, what's the impact of Chinese market into product building? I mean, probably did they get the idea maybe from Kickstarter, which is a crowdfunding, I guess? That would be a cheaper production of the product. So how does it feel 30 years after?
Oh.
What's the change in the situation? Does it feel different or?
In the 3D printing market specifically?
Or general production of products?
Yeah, I mean, it's such a different mindset today than it was, you know, back in 94. So Kickstarter is an amazing thing. There's so much more capital available today than there was back then. Although there still remains a bias against hardware because the gross margins are different, and typically there isn't a recurring revenue stream with hardware. So it's often more challenging to get funding as a hardware business. But overall, I think the culture around the world is much more aspirational to being an entrepreneur than they were 30 years ago. And that's all very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for your interesting comments. I think one of the most inspiring parts of your presentation is how you actually managed to keep a team 30 years ago. And would you like to elaborate more on, I don't know, your inside feedback on partnerships and team building? How do you keep balance with, say, the incentives? Because I think one of the usual problems when you're into entrepreneurship in the brackets of startups is that you have a lot of people coming and a lot of people going.
Yeah.
So.
So, yeah, I mean, everyone on the team really believed in it. I mean, it was like a religion, you know. Everyone really had a passion for our technology, and they were driven by different things. Everyone was driven to have it be successful, and it was not, and so I think the key is understanding what it is that drives people. So for our engineers, it was being innovative, being able to think out of the box, having the freedom to use their minds and push things forward. And we were able to free them up by building in a team that could do the more mundane tasks that they didn't want to do, for example. So that would be a good example where, you know, we had a team of engineers that did the sort of boring stuff of building an actual reliable product that works every time, so that the more free-thinking, creative thinkers could do their thing. So it's a question of finding out what motivates people and keying into that. With our sales guys, keeping them on commission so that they wanted to sell more.
Because it's like there is a split pie. Partially it's the responsibilities and partially it's the incentive.
Yeah.
And I think the most challenging part is the incentives.
Yeah, so we paid below market salary to everyone and gave them equity. So everyone was a shareholder. And we gave equity all the way down to people on the manufacturing floor, had equity in the business. And we invited them to board meetings to see what we were doing, how we were doing. And we had people, and one thing we did, we believed that our equity was the most valuable thing we had to give. And we gave it because we wanted people to feel like owners. And when we saw people acting like owners, we gave equity. So we had a guy, he was really interesting. He had been in prison and had come out of prison and was doing drywall. I don't know what that's called. Do you know what drywall is? It's when you're making a building, when you put, before you paint, when you put the cement on. Yeah. So he was doing that and had done that for a house that we were building. And he was really good. He was very, very careful and methodical. So we hired him in the company. And so here's a guy out of prison doing that. He was phenomenal. He was the most amazing technician. And he behaved like an owner. So he would go out to fix the machines in the field. And then he would come back and scream at the engineers, like, you guys have to fix this problem. Let me explain to you what the customers are doing and how you need to fix it and why you need to fix it. And he would get very specific into the details with the engineers, and he wouldn't let something go. He would make sure to get things fixed. And that kind of ownership, caring, not just about like dum-de-dum, 9 to 5, doing my job, but really caring about the product and the company to make us be successful. So he had a very disproportionate share of equity relative to anyone at his level. It's not like we promoted him to be vice president. He was still a service technician, but he owned a lot of the company, a lot more than he would have otherwise.
I wanted to ask you a people question. Told you. I wanted to clarify the point where you mentioned about the complainers, because in a couple of sessions in my leadership class, I will actually be telling the students that the complainers can be positive in an organization, because the complainers who ask the tough questions may be the ones who question the status quo actually help us to go forward. So
I'd like to make a distinction.
Okay.
Because we had a culture that was actually very, I would say almost combative in a very positive way, that you were encouraged to give your opinion. And if you agreed with everything that was said, then you probably weren't adding a lot of value. So we disagreed a lot, and we encouraged people at all levels. And in fact, we tried to have decision-making go to the lowest possible level, because our feeling was that the lower the level, the more information you had. And so we very much encouraged people to disagree and to fight it out, to really argue it out. That's not what I'm talking about. I very much believe in that. And there's nothing more that I hated than people who just agreed with everything I said. I hated that. But the complainers I'm talking about are the people who would poison the organization with a negative attitude. Like, oh God, this is so stupid. I don't know why we're doing this project. This is the dumbest project ever. And you know, management doesn't know what they're doing.
Thanks. Any other questions? Yes, please. Another 2 questions, yes.
Which industry? Yeah, which industry
markets? The one that I don't know. by the time people are talking about it, you've missed the boat. So it's you're going to think of something. I tell you, when you know you're onto something is when people look at you funny. And, you know, it's so funny because today everyone knows what 3D printing is. I mean, it cracks me up. Just yesterday I was in the taxi from the Cyprus airport, and the guy was asking my background, and I said, 3D printing, do you know what that is? He's like, videos. I'm like, oh my God, like, we've come a long way. When I was selling this product, I would call top engineers around the world. Nobody knew what 3D printing was. Nobody knew what it was. And that's when you're onto something. When nobody knows what you're talking about, it means you're innovative. When people give you a funny look and they're like, wait, what? You know, like Uber, when Uber first came along, you're like, wait, what? How does that work? That's when you know you're onto something innovative. By the time, if I said to you, Internet of Things, okay, psh, we're, you know, that market, the stuff that is happening in Internet of Things, the people who are in it already are innovating right now. But by the time you get out of school and think of something and come up with it and develop it, you know, that ship may have sailed by that point. So it's whatever we're not talking about right now.
Okay, never underestimate the taxi drivers in Cyprus, you know.
So
one last question in the back.
My question is, in order to make a successful pitching, is it always necessary to show an abstract of your product or service, or it's not necessary to do this?
Yes, you should show something. And so if you, let's say it's a software product and you don't have it yet, you haven't developed it, do a storyboard, even if it's by hand. Just show, like, what is it going to look like? Just so I can see, I can visualize what you're talking about. It can be rough. It doesn't have to be a final finished product, but you want to convey, you want to think about the investor who knows nothing. How can you get them up to speed as quickly as possible? And usually a picture is worth 1,000 words.
Okay, thank you very much. One note from the director.
Yes, έχουμε 7,000 συνειδητές, 22,000 απόφασεις. Χρειάζονται μερικές 4, 5, 6 καλές ιδέες για να απογειώσουμε τη χώρα. Και είμαι σίγουρος ότι τις έχετε. Θα ήθελα επίσης να πω ότι πριν από 6 μήνες ο αντιπρόεδρος του Συμβουλίου του Πανεπιστημίου, ο κύριος Γιώργος Δαβίδ, ήρθε στο γραφείο μου και μου είπε πρέπει να καλέσεις την κυρία Μαρίνα Χατζόπουλος. Νομίζω είχε απόλυτο δίκιο. Ο κύριος Δαβίδ δεν είναι απόψη μαζί μας. Τον ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ και σας ευχαριστούμε και εσάς πάρα πολύ για αυτή τη διάλεξη. Να είστε καλά.
Ευχαριστώ.